think the most important lesson I've learned is to step in somebody else's shoes. I think it's very easy to get carried away when you're the muscle power, you've got the technology, the network, the solution, you're powerful money-wise, that you forget about what it means to the doctor, what it means to the hospital, the sort of interests and precautions that governments have to take. So I think it's really important to actually take on the needs of stakeholders. I also think in Afghanistan it's been important to know which stakeholders to involve and which stakeholders to keep informed. And I say that with a smile, because sometimes if you go and tackle legislation, regulation, etc., that's a huge thing to tackle. It's usually best to keep those entities informed, start small, perfect it, grow it, get the practitioners who are going to deliver it to take it on board, be able to support it, and then go back and say, hey, look, look what we can do. Now, will you join us? Can we do more? I think. I wish I knew that 3-4 years ago when this started. I've had to learn the hard way.
Healthcare is full of really bad incentives and siloed budgets. So there are budgets for doing the wrong thing and no budgets for doing the right thing. Or very few. You've got to find those ones and you lever them to make change happen. And then you overcome their bad budgets and bad purchasing decisions. And if I knew now what I knew then, I would have made the 3 years into 1 year somehow.
I think sometimes it happens that we basically do pilots in a very large market and most of them fail. Sometimes there is no correct incentivizing model between the stakeholders because of which the models fail. And most of the people in entrepreneur feel that things which are simple are stupid, which is not the case. I mean, the more simpler things are, the more convenient and user-friendly they are. I think they take off pretty easily, much more than any gadget and Zigmo kind of stuff would do. But I think that several such things which require a lot of technology and application, the stamp that it can be used and it can be deployed comes from the healthcare providers. So don't miss on the doctor in the value chain otherwise. I mean, they should not feel insecure.
If you're going to do B2B and be in health management and servicing doctors, you're talking about 3, 5, 7 year commitment. You have to be funded or just willing to eat a lot of cup and almond to survive, and your teams have to survive. And you need data. You have to do pilot projects, clinical trials, and there are only a few companies, you know, sponsors, who can pay you, sponsors.
In order for this to work, it really needs to be clinically led, and it needs to be accepted by the person that's receiving the treatment. If you don't have those two, you don't have an mHealth solution.
I think that, you know, technology has never been the issue. Technology is moving on its pace. That's a good pace. The main resistance comes from the healthcare providers. Being a physician myself and having interacted with physicians in the last 12, 13 years, trying to convince them for e-health or telemedicine, I see that the mindset of the physicians and the regulators itself is the biggest barrier in the advancement of delivery of healthcare through information technology. So if we are able to, you know, manage that aspect, the pace will really, you know, it will increase, and we will reach the ultimate beneficiary, which is the patient, in a quicker manner.
Well, in the Netherlands, like in many European countries, we have already a healthcare system, and especially the financing and the reimbursement of healthcare is a great barrier for mHealth applications. So I think we should really start with piloting new initiatives and then take it a step further by scaling them up and lobby for other regulations and reimbursement rules.
The lessons learned are really, well, to look for what's already out there, and even maybe share funds on doing the same stuff if you're next to each other. But it's very difficult, of course, and the majority of the organizations dropping into a country like Uganda and setting up an mHealth project to see if this will work in the western part are bringing in their own technology, their own content, and even with language barriers and with technology barriers, you cannot bring high-tech into a low-tech country. These programs will not be as successful as they will be thought of on the drawing tables in the big offices in the developed world. Mm. So, yeah, look also for local software, hardware development, and especially local country. Work with people in the country where you're active, and don't think of anything alone in your big office, but try to collaborate on the ground as well. Then it could be more successful, but it's still a future. We're not there yet.
It's a clear three-pointer. The disease burden is pretty high. The mobile penetration is big. You need technology to hover over to reach out to these million people. So come on, let's do it. It's like, don't think twice. Don't think about the 2G and the 3G and everything of that sort. Whatever you have with whatever infrastructure you find, just go deploy it. See, I mean, I think that's the way ahead. We have to start somewhere, and I think if we start now, it's like the first mover advantage. Yeah.